A very good evening and welcome to this edition of the Fourth Estate. Charles Mungu Shampagi is my name. On Friday, we witnessed yet another gruesome murder happening in broad daylight in the morning and on the killing of a very high-profile security officer, Assistant Inspector General of Police, Andrew Felix Kaweesi. Now, Felix Kaweesi is a person who was working very closely with the media. We interviewed him on this show several times and we spoke to him in other reporting businesses, especially given his work, some time working as in charge of Kampala Metropolitan Police, also heading operations, and most recently as a spokesperson of the Uganda Police Force. A requiem mass was held for Andrew Felix Kaweesi this evening at the church he went to in Chigowa and Tinda, in Tinda Kisasi, this evening, and the president spoke at his home just this evening. I'm making some very strong statements about the state of our security. We'll be discussing that. And of course, I need not forget to mention that Andrew Felix Kaweesi was killed alongside other policemen, Kenneth Erau, his bodyguard, and Godfrey Nambeo. I think that's how the name is. Godfrey Nambeo, his driver. Both were killed on Friday morning. We don't need to forget that. To discuss the state of our security, what is behind the growing spate of criminality? Is it ordinary criminality, targeted killings? What does this mean for your security and my security? We brought in studio tonight the Minister for Security, Brigadier Henry Tumkunde. You're most welcome, sir.
Lieutenant General.
Good evening, viewers.
My apologies for missing the correct rank. Honor Peter Ekomoloit. His permanent furniture is part of the furniture of the Fourth Estate. Very nice to have you again.
I'm happy to be permanent.
No, a permanent part of the show. And a private investigator, Freddie David Egesa. Freddie David Egesa has been a private investigator since 1993. So that's about 20 years. About 24 years. As a private investigator, and you have investigated, among others, murder cases.
Several cases.
You're most welcome.
Good evening, viewers.
I want to go straight to the minister and ask the question that everybody has been asking since Felix Kaweesi's murder and the other two policemen on Friday. For an incident that happened, yes, I know you made comments on that day. For someone of such a profile, guarded, with that kind of protection that he has, in broad daylight, in a suburb of the city, how safe are ordinary Ugandans?
Well, first of all, thank you for inviting us here. And I want to begin by passing my sincere condolences to the family of Andrew Kaweesi. And of course, Kenneth, and the escort, Wambio, and their wives and children. We sincerely feel with them. And then to your question, maybe I should tackle it one by one. The first point you are making is broad daylight.
Yes.
And the second point you are raising, high profile in the suburb of Kampala. First and foremost, we need to distinguish the kind of crime that is coming before us. There is crime, maybe whose motives are money making, whose motives are any of those usually selfish guided motives. And that's where you have people who want to steal for money, people who want to. Now, the second case is political crime. And these days has gained many names. Called terrorism, it's called, as far as I'm concerned, I would want that we look at this from very many angles. I look at Kaweesi's murder as a terrorist act. Of course, I know there are very many versions how this must be an internal job. I had it being raised before I came here. How this is maybe state managed. But for a person whose business it is to provide security for the Republic of Uganda, what should concern us most is broad daylight, yes, that's confidence. Conclusive clinical tackle, making sure you complete a task. And then what else was very special was the comfort. I think it took about 10 minutes. People should be rushing off, should be going off. Now, what this can only imply is that these people have gained confidence. It means they've done it once or twice. And they've gained that confidence. And of course, that's why sometimes when you come up with these kind of pictures like I saw today in the press, the worst you can ever do to such a suspect is if you communicate to him that you don't know him.
Are you referring
if
to the one,
for example, the image?
Yes, the composites that police has provided.
Of yourself comes out as the image of myself. Maybe in your case there can be some bit of connection. Strange. Then the only thing this does, it gives confidence to this person that something that he's your offside. Now, that is not the bigger point, because the job of forensics is to try to give an image to the public. So, but you need to be zeroed. If you are not zeroed, it is advisable that you'd rather
not give anything.
Maybe not give anything. However, analyzing this very case, yes, confidence, I have done it twice and I have not been gotten. Or I have maybe internal connections. I think the president raised something today about corruption. You know, sometimes in pursuance of corruption, you may even kill your own brother without knowing, just because you think you are trying to make some benefit. So, the other point that would give this kind of confidence is when you pick your best amongst your operators, if you are a terrorist, and you make him dare take such a special move. This is an unusual move. This is meaning to dishearten your opponent. You get your best, he takes out such a very, very important person. I think this was a very, very efficient office. Extremely efficient, and I think to a large extent very professional. Now, you get your best terrorist, you say go, put out Kaweesi for the sake of disheartening the opponent. Now, what dangers do you suffer here? You suffer the operators withdrawing. Like today, a stone was thrown at one of our NRM officials, and I was consulted, contacted immediately. That terror has hit one of our, and I think it was just a simple crime. So, in the case of Kaweesi, take out that critical top, like you call it, then cause terror to the other side, so that those who operated beside him with confidence are necessarily derailed or they fear. Now, the other dimension to this crime is that there could be a new force. It doesn't have to be what we know. This new force hits between the gaps. That's what professional terrorists do. I don't know if there's anything called professional, but professional that have advanced, I mean terrorists that have advanced to those levels, they do such acts. Now, in this case, therefore, what should engage us? What should engage us is, first of all, to isolate this level. This is a sophisticated enemy, and we must find him out of the mud, out of the mesh, and tackle him at that level.
Someone would raise a question right there.
Yes.
This is not the first killing. If you look at the killing of Major Muhammad Chigund, broad daylight, morning, same approach, same audacity. The killing of Joan Kagezi, from the DPP's office, evening followed, and the president talked about that this evening. The killing of the Muslim sheikhs. You're counting now close to 17 people, if you add the collateral damage, which is the bodyguard and driver, two with Kaweesi, one with Muhammad Chigundu. If you're looking at that, the thoroughness, the audacity, what you said, what you called conclusiveness of a clinical nature to a clinical tackle to complete the job. It's been running for some time, and it's been running now almost 6 years without us having an answer that says this is the conclusive investigation that we have taken and we have isolated this case. So it's been growing.
Well, you see, when we tackle terrorists in town, by the way, I don't want to categorically grade this crime as one and part of all you've mentioned. It could be part, because the pattern has the same trends, but it could be another. Yes, like you've seen the change from the Al-Qaeda to ISIS to who, you know, so it could be another. But let me zero on if it was the case of. Number one, let me take you back to the days when terrorism hit this country and we are getting bombs. A bomb blew up in Angenois, a grenade actually. And those days people said this is drunkards, military drunkards, and the grenade has just fallen out. Many other incidents took place. That's when, over time, we drew a pattern to the whole matter and we took it on. The success to this kind of operations is largely, first of all, joint operations. So, one, we now know this is not usual. And we now know is a pattern. And we now will have, you see, in the days before, we were concentrating on public order. It was disrupting the city and business was going wrong. So police concentrated on public order, and for us, we are functioning intelligence on public order. Now, there is an outright new threat. It has touched one of us. We shall now zero and
what you're saying in essence that you have been investing a lot in political intelligence and allowed criminality to grow.
But you see, there are some fundamentals. You go with all these together. You can't, but there is one you must emphasize. Depending on, you see, we are a democracy. And we depend entirely on accounting to the public. If the public at a certain particular time is concerned about a certain subject, that's where we put the time. Yes, because you can only answer to the public. We are accountable. Of course, that doesn't affect our assessment of what is more dangerous or the assessment of threat. No, but we have to respond to what sometimes alarms the public.
Okay.
Now, as of today, I would want to give you information that in the last 3 days I've been piling quite a number of things. As of today, radar number one, the Republic of Uganda and the citizens are saying no. Terrorism, we have a problem. Now, our job therefore now is to go in
and dissect this matter.
Was
Kagezi similar? Was similar? Chigundu and Kagezi, you can have some similarity. Chigundu served with ADF, I hope you know.
Mm-hmm.
So maybe that can be an angle to it. And then Kagezi prosecuted ADF. That's a connection. Now you can maybe add on Kaweesi, maybe as having been an effective counter in this town.
The president said today that the people who killed Kagezi were known or unknown. What we haven't seen is that these people have actually been arrested or not.
Well, I listened to the president and I am in a slightly different branch of security. Me, I am doing the intelligence. So once the president says so, maybe it is known. I think it is known. But let's go to, if it is known.
I'm afraid, General, I'm being advised that we need to take a quick break to correct something small, and then we come back to the discussion shortly. So, gentlemen, I'll come to you after a short commercial break. We'll break. Welcome back to this edition of the Fourth Estate, and we're discussing the state of our security with the Security Minister, Lieutenant General Henry Tumkunde, Hon. Peter Komoloit, and Freddie David Egesa, who is a private investigator. Gentlemen, I'll come to you in a minute. Let me just come back to the Minister for one small question. In your view, so far, what are the glaring gaps in security that have led to this incident? Because not one incident, there are many.
First of all, I'm not too sure if when all this happens, it is because there are necessary gaps. Sometimes intelligence and security are surprised by a new form of, you know, crime, for example, a new form of terrorist acts, a new group. It's not necessarily something, but if I could do summarize, one, it's sometimes technical competence. We need to have sufficient technical competence. Many things have happened since 1986. We need to have more technical competence than we happen to have. That's number one. I've seen the incident of Russia. I don't know how far true it is, penetrating
the U.S. system.
So it depends on where you invest your. Number two, we have a set of people we've been relying on. But you know, security is dynamic. We may have to bring in a new set. For example, cybersecurity. You need to bring in a new set that have got mastery on cybersecurity, for example. It's the human and the technical machines that combine to turn out what you'd call an intelligence result. Now, in this particular case, the debate inside us is, what do we do with our old group? They've been holding this country together. They are such a been an asset. So how do we have? Usually, we should see the move very well, for example.
Mm-hmm.
But sometimes your budget does not provide this kind of money. Because at the end of the day, you talk about gaps. Maybe it's also how much investment you put in security. Of course, I'm sure for you, say, if it is taking such a budget of the country, then that's enough. No, it may be about the magnitude of the threat.
Mm-hmm.
The magnitude of the threat may be even bigger than the whole economy, the whole budget of the economy.
But
so the issue is, do we put in enough? Now, I've told you technicals, and then new brains that have got to be sharpened to work with this set of equipment, we will turn out a good intelligence result. That I would call a gap. The second, the other gap I could look at maybe is for such an operation, you need to jointly operate together. Pull in all the resources, pull in all the intelligence, share
even budgets where possible, do everything and turn out results.
Okay.
So the other gaps I could see is the typical gap of being too peaceful. I hope
really?
You know that also is a problem on its own. Yes. The Uganda of yesterday, of wars in northern Uganda, of so many things which you know. There has been a period now when we've been really a bit, you know,
yeah,
calm.
But I'll say the word.
You know what that does even to a country like Nigeria? By the time Nigeria, Boko Haram came in, you don't know what happened to them. They
let me
had been too relaxed for too long.
Yes,
after
let me bring
online
for this discussion.
Yes.
You see, the string of assassination is one bit. But in terms of being security, as the minister, having security for being peaceful for too long, the monitor has been running a series of investigative pieces of the murders going on in Teso sub-region from Friday, Saturday, and today. The president was referencing something in Rakai. One family killed 9 people. We had, and we're seeing top security officials, the inspector general of police, running from one high crime area to another high crime area. It was in Chirhura, some stage in Bushenyi. I remember they sent Asan Kasinje in Busoga sub-region, and now in Teso sub-region. Generally, people have been killed, people have been murdered. Yeah? And that doesn't come with like a lot of peace.
I think, in my opinion, I would categorize the kind of crime one would worry about into two elements. I think this country, to the credit of the security apparatus, is, I think, does not have what I would call random crime. But I think it has organized crime. By random crime, I mean you and I can get out of this studio fairly comfortable that we can drive to our houses and wake up tomorrow. And the chances are very high that it will happen. But I think now what we are witnessing is targeted, organized crime. And the biggest threat is really to the elite society. People who are either having money, who have good jobs, because this kind of crime is organized by someone who has get you for one reason or the other. So I think the challenge for the general and his counterparts is how to deal with organized crime. But in terms of random crime, I would always defend that this country and even this city is quite a safe place.
Mm.
You don't have no-go areas. You don't have, at any one point in time, you can actually move across the city. The city basically doesn't sleep, for example. You go right now, people will be out in Wandegia, in Tinda, they are trading, and they are fairly safe. But when someone wants to get you, I think that's where the police and other operators are not able to identify those who have acquired the capacity to get others and get away with it. I think that's where the problem is.
Mr. Gessa, what do you make all this? Crime happens and people are able to disappear in thin air during broad daylight.
First of all, my condolences to the family of Kaweesi Felix. Let's look at this. I've always said that a sick cat will give all the rats a chance to develop and do whatever they want. You know, crime is a monster. We come from different trainings and possibly thoughts, but crime is a monster that can be suffocated, to be so lean, or that can be, if left unattended, it will gain stature, it will become a nuisance, it will become a problem. Now, let's not discuss the death of Kaweesi in isolation. There are so many deaths, there are so many unsolved murders in this country, and we do not even seem to be solving even a quarter of these murders. First and foremost, we should accept that the system that has been handling investigation of murders is faulty. If we do not make that conclusion, we shall be going into circles. Yeah, the system that has been investigated, I think to me, I will not be possibly as diplomatic as the general and him. I'll say, sincerely speaking, the setup we had, which was almost being run by Kalika Ihura, that system has to be overhauled. If we don't overhaul that system, then there is a big, big problem. Of course, one of the main One of the main fibers of intelligence is how information flows from the best people. I do not believe with Enapito when he says that the city is safe. The city is not safe. The city has so many black spots. The city has so many go areas. I'll give an example. In Kenya, they used to have rapists all over, and they created what they termed as the Scorpion Squad. These were girls. They could carry small arms, and they could waylay the thugs and dealt with them. Here, you can imagine, it is the affluent, it is the rich people who can drive. But people on foot, people who wake up like in the morning to go and work in markets, they are not safe. You hear alarms every other time. So we should say that there has been a problem. And once we design a conclusion that the system that has been in place, security-wise, is faulty, then we say, let's overhaul it, let several other people come into play, possibly people who can rhyme with the Kali. Because at the end of the day, when you look at CID, I've been seeing CID. CID has been all the fibers, the strong guys like the Choms, the strong guys like the Musana, these are guys who know intelligence. They have been pulled out and they are seated redundant at headquarters. Go to regional CIDs. You find that young men of 27 are running these offices. Yes, in the police there are three things or four. One, there should be adequate and proper training. Through colleges, then you are trained through orientation by guys who are experienced. So, as you look at things now, if you find some of the files being handled, sometimes you blame the DPP, but some of these files are very hollow because the fiber of investigation, the fiber of intelligence that has been in place has been a problem. Lastly, maybe I would say that there has not been a center where information from the public is comfortably received and shared. Possibly I will request the general now to take that on, because I know that there has been a problem with the police. You tell a policeman one thing, tomorrow you may never know how it comes up. And then the removal of special branch from the police was a blunder, because we are talking about guns here, and we are discussing guns. Who monitors the guns being carried by police? Are they monitored? So we should, you know, let's just be open, because the public is suffering and we are suffering. And anybody can be targeted any time. So if we are to come up with anything, we should be very, very genuine to each other and should be open.
General, let me come back to you. One is the question of proliferation of guns. One count, I think, has said about maybe 19,000 guns out in private hands. Nobody knows where they are. Who has what kind of guns? People disappear with guns. Talking about general safety. We have a plethora of intelligence agencies. Now, you coordinate security, you coordinate intelligence. We have so many intelligence agencies. The president was referring to intelligence officers as low as parish level. Parish internal security officer, PISO. Regional internal security officer, up to the Minister for Security. Is it a question of lack of resources, it's a question of lack of personnel? When we have so much, the IGP has told us he has 11 million crime preventers.
Imagine,
11 million.
Imagine having a piece of which cannot peel. That's just unusual.
11 million crime preventers, all these security agencies in gathering evidence. How come there's something going wrong? There's something wrong, definitely somewhere.
I don't know if I got your question very well.
My question is, there are so many intelligence agencies.
Mm-hmm.
There is so much
agencies or agents?
Agents and agencies.
Because I only know two or three intelligence agencies. Anyway, go ahead.
Yes. How can we have so many agencies and agents going up to the level of parish level, and yet information flow is as difficult as it is?
You see, even in security, there is specialization. The job of intelligence is to gather information, refine the information, and forward it for use. For example, ordinarily, except in the old days. By the way, I can tell you, you don't have to waste time on it. Just tell me tomorrow that I can pick somebody and arrest him. And there are no 48 hours rules, there are no whatever, And I can tell you very easily that that's something we can solve. But we are a democracy.
Mm-hmm.
Certain people must arrest. Certain people must investigate. Certain people must prosecute. Certain people must judge cases. It's a chain. Some people, other people must hold these people like prisons. It's a chain. So, intelligence may be giving this information. The whole issue is, how is it utilized? Maybe that's enough. But again, there's also what Mr. Gessa was saying. There's specialization. The issues of crime are issues of police, as you know. For me, actually, why I'm now up and sleep, it's because now I think this is no longer ordinary crime. He tried to do, and we are going to take time. I give assurances to Uganda, we'll sort it out. But also know that we act in sometimes very difficult circumstances, Mr. Wangri. You arrest somebody today, tomorrow, the 48 hours rule will work, this guy will get out. Even when you are still, you know, mobilizing, you know, evidence, even when you are still doing some investigation in the local town where he stays, he finds you there. Of course, there's also issues of corruption. I think if you were saying we are being too deep on corruption. How long does this man stay? Is he being pursued? And will the file be tampered with? Today I was in Rukunji handling a matter. Somebody has a very outright case. And you know what happened? RSA, they call them resident state attorney. He has said that according to him, the circumstances, I mean the evidence on the file, you know the court has, yes, the court has a ruling which says that what matters in court is not the truth. It is evidence. Now, if this person says I don't have enough evidence, this man is already back on the street.
But Charles, I think...
So, it brings in quite a number
of... don't mind,
yes.
A lot of emphasis is being put on holding people in jail as a solution to a case. I don't think that's necessary. So, in this modern era, when you have a lot of technology where you can do surveillance, whether someone is in a police cell or they are out, it does not mean the case should end. So I think the demand that people should not be released, even when the law allows them to be released, maybe it's not necessarily a fair demand.
Well,
I know you
suffered. You better look at this test.
Yes.
Honorable Naputo, you go to the case of the American.
Guantanamo.
And you go to sometimes, and you know, I myself am a chief, you know, campaigner of rights. Because I know what it means not to have your rights.
Yeah.
So, however, if somebody is still being investigated, and maybe he has some reasoning on money, and he has certain means, he has influence, and in one day he goes back to where he committed the crime. I know. We wrote this law together. I was with you. We wrote the constitution. And I'm a lawyer. I must respect the law. And we serve a democracy. We must behave as the rules run.
But General, you can't rule out the fact that you have organized criminal gangs operating in this town. They say it's very easy. If one of people owes me money, there are people you can call. They'll pick him up. They'll torture him. And they will extort from him or do anything they want from him. And it will go unpunished.
Mr. Mangusha, I have always condemned lawlessness as a means of survival. You know that. I came here condemning to face you, although they've gone down because we are taking them on. But still, these limitations, you can imagine those very structures.
Mm-hmm.
If they are not efficient, one efficiency is not sufficient.
The president today told the police to clean up their house.
Mm-hmm.
My interpretation is that he was speaking to a broader section of people involved in providing security and fighting crime in this town, in this country.
Yeah.
He was not just speaking to the police alone.
By the way...
And at his position, you'd expect that the president...
Mr. Mwangusha,
yes.
Let me tell you one thing. The way we are, you can only clean up yourself. Shame is a revolutionary sentiment. I can tell you this. And I happen to be part of this machine. I don't want to wash my hands off.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, we have to clean up ourselves. Clean up corruption, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
But again, we also maybe have to look at other aspects that facilitates crime. And we have to look at it, and doesn't have to be what the ordinary one has to. We don't have to change the law. Mm. But for example, we have to change people who manage the law.
Yeah, and Charles, I think if I may chip in there, part of the cleaning up the president needs to see through is, I know it worked well for the NRM during the Bush days.
Yeah.
Fusion of the state actors and the ordinary civilians to allow free flow of information. But I think it has gone overboard. The whole concept of crime preventers, for example, was noble, maybe in some ways,
yeah,
but over time it might have lost course. So you have a lot of, you say, specialization that you are demanding. Who is a professional policeman and who is just a vigilante?
I want to say something here.
The president was saying there has been infiltration, but how do you separate people who are helping police seemingly and who are criminal? And this goes all the way from the villages. People who are supposed to give information.
I just want to say something here. First and foremost, let's just try to understand how our police works. Police, in any way, you know, when you look at the way the police structures are now, you'll find that there's what we call the modern police, vis-a-vis the colonial police where several people, possibly some of us, belonged. Now, in the modern policing, you find that there is a kind of a draconian way of doing things. Because ordinarily, in any policing, like, you know, police has been in charge of several statutory issues. There could have been what we call statutory, you know, what we call maybe think tanks,
mm-hmm,
where people conference and decide on issues. But what appears to me in police is almost like a dictatorial direction. You know, as much as people are not allowed to say what they want to say, people will keep quiet with their expertise, people keep quiet with their information, and just let someone drive something the way he wants.
Mm-hmm.
And now, once that happens, it will be like, you know, you can work with so many people, and in a way, they're kind of sabotaging you. How an officer, like in intelligence, may choose not to give you information, may choose to be withdrawn, may feel that, like we have seen, most of these very, very people, many of them, of course, are retiring and going out. There's no problem. It could have been that they would have offloaded the experience. Two, if you look at a situation today, you find the regional CID officer is only 27 or 30 years and is commanding people who are very, very old now. That wouldn't be a problem if he had the capacity and the knowledge and everything.
Mm.
So if you looked at all this, and maybe I would also mention...
Mr. Kisa, if I could cut in. Aren't you looking at this, the hit on AIGP Kaweesi as ordinary crime? If this is targeted political crime, as the minister told us, or maybe some kind of terrorism.
Any form of killing, once life is taken unlawfully, it's a terrorism. We could give it several other names, but it's a terrorism. Look at the body of a girl that was recovered in a suitcase in Chengela. That's a terrorism. You know, there is what we call domestic security. You know, police is supposed to manage domestic security. Domestic security involves the normal person, the local person who walks on the street. I mean, the safety of that very, very person, the safety of your house, or even the way information comes freely into the hands of the authority and how it is shifted and how it is worked on.
Mm.
So if we are talking about terrorism, Katayimbwa people, you call them what? Talk about mob justice. Do you know that we lose over 1,000 people in mob justice a year? Now, those are big numbers of deaths. What is happening? Why aren't we able to dislodge the Katayimbwa people? Why aren't we able to dislodge the rapists? Why is it that now criminals are getting more strong, more organized, and more accurate? So let's not just look at one death in isolation.
Can we put those to the minister? Because why? You have a series. You have Katayimbwa people. You have people killing mobile money operators. The other day, you have a kidnap and a killing of these two Chinese girls, and it's gone without stress. Mr. Minister, I want to put a straight question to you. Do we have organized hit squads running this city and in this country?
Organized hit squads?
Yes.
What I know exists in this city is lawless, organized elements. I don't know if they are hit squads, because that is not something I can be too sure about. But they are collaborating with some elements of our own security. That's the corruption the president was talking about. That one could be there. But for me, as far as I'm concerned, how you tackle crime, number one, the law must be functional,
mm-hmm.
and addressing the correct issues that are critical to crime. Secondly, you must have investigative capacity. Thirdly, you must have prosecuting speed and competence. Fourth, the judiciary should be able to turn around cases. Now, in this, in all these, there are different spectrums of government. You know very well who handled this matter. But what I can bring out as very, very important is that we operate with certain limitations. You can't do certain things. And you stop at a point. Somebody else must take on from there. If police investigates the matter and hands it over to somebody else, must prosecute this matter, I mean this case, and land it is conclusive.
So the failure is that you're not coordinated within government?
The failure is that the
or you're knocking against each other.
The different systems don't have the same feelings, if I may use that, about the urgency of this matter.
So what does that say?
It says that different levels have got different appreciations of this very problem. By the way,
the effect of that is that people are dying.
Yes, really, I'm telling you that that's not good. But let me also raise something that is very, very important. For the Kaweesi kind of crime, the underlying competence you must have is intelligence. You must have correct intelligence. Who are these people? What means do they have? Who finances them? How do they operate? Who do they deal with? There are things you must have cleared in your hands. And if you don't emphasize intelligence, you stand the danger of being merely a postmortem. You know what I mean? Intelligence.
But general,
let's take a break. Can I pick this up after a short commercial break? We'll be right back. Welcome to this last segment of the Fourth Estate with the Security Minister, Lieutenant General Henry Tumkunde, and David Freddy Egesa, who is a private investigator, and of course my colleague, Honor Peter Komale. You wanted to write something, Honor, just before you...
I was going to ask General Tumkunde, he's emphasizing the need for intelligence, but there's a general perception in this city that most of the border, for example, are part of the intelligence, which is good, because they are spread out. So if the killers were seen to be border borders and they went into an area where you have other border people, why up to this point have they been able to perhaps indicate that there were guys here whom we didn't know and they were riding this kind of bike? That's one question. The other thing I wanted to comment on was the question of, you say there's kind of lack of common interest. For me, I think the biggest problem in this country still is influence peddling. When people get arrested, do you know me? And they are calling people, you know? And somehow there's someone responding for them and trying to interfere with the prosecution, with the police action. Until when we break that culture where if someone is arrested, it's only the law and not another person's influence to save them, it's going to be very difficult to fight crime.
You see, I know you have some prisoner background and some of these matters. The other day I was in Kagadi. When they touch somebody who has entered Uganda illegally, but because he can vote, Then now you get politicians, you get the other day I have to call them to address them, gentlemen, get out of this. Like you are saying, influence peddling, money insertions, and many of these things. But you see, any person serving on behalf of government, because there is also a feeling that people are not, if you are not paid well, maybe you had better take sides. Because where will you get this budget paid people as expected, as their expectations? But back to this issue. If you can't train somebody, I'm now going back to your border case. If you can't train somebody, he raised it, and I know he's on. If you can't train somebody and command control him properly, my view is that he should never be counted as part of any security arrangement. If it is border, he must be controllable, he must be trainable, he must be manageable. Maybe if he's just a source of information, that's another matter. For example, when I came here, I remember I raised issues with this very, about, for example, I have even a sample in my, and I've raised it with many forums, about security tags on every number. Yes. Let Wavamuno print the number. Forward it somewhere and we security tag. In today's world, it's not enough to just manufacture numbers. And you know very well how many groups of border are in this town. They are very helpful. They've helped us. But if you don't manage and control them very well, they become your own, actually. They are counterproductive. They can become very, very dangerous for you. If you can't train somebody and if you can't, you should not count him as part of any. I'm sure Mr. Guest agrees with it. He should never be counted as part of a
but
security
network. Recruited
you them. Can
you
be an informer.
Yes.
You understand? Like you can have informers, but they should never be owned by a security agency or even a police force as part of them until they are properly refined and touched.
So what we're saying, what I'm saying is that you've created the monster in people riding on motorcycles. Border have been coming up in arms and saying, don't condemn border. But recruited them, armed them. It's not a surprise that you'd sit on what you think is an ordinary border and only feel someone is carrying a gun. They're carrying them. And they're all over the place. Uncontrollable. There is a demonstration in town, a small demonstration. And people are popping up from all sorts of corners, and they are armed. Who are these people? Where are they coming from? Who manages them?
Do you know what is the fundamental about any security of a country? The personnel running that security, the equipment, and the technology must be under proper command and control.
Is that?
I don't know if we have armed borders. Mm-hmm. Maybe I must. Say I'm fairly new. I've not been here for some time.
Mm. That would be interesting. For people watching you to say you're fairly new.
Well, yeah, I was out.
Yes,
you have quite
sometime,
a period.
Yeah.
You have to learn things. That's the point he was raising. You have to feel in yourself. But what I am saying, I don't think anyone has armed borders with an intention that they use arms for purposes of providing security where they are. Because there is absence of command and control. If you can't command and control anybody in a security network, it's dangerous. Allow that very person to try to own the name of that security arrangement. For example, to be called an IO, there are some minimum things you must beat. One of them is minimum training. You must also respond to orders. You must have the capacity to handle weapons. You must even have the capacity to assess documents and analyze between information and intelligence. It's a thin layer, but it's very, very important. If you cannot, you should never wear the name of a security establishment.
How do you feel, General, when you see people giving orders? There is an operation going on, it could be a political demonstration, and you see strange people giving orders, even to uniformed officers and men.
And they are carrying sticks.
And some are carrying sticks, others are carrying guns. And that's the security apparatus that we apparently have.
You see, if you are an undercover security person, Mr. Gessa should tell you this. We will share it. He knows bits of it. If you are an undercover security person, even in the critical most of circumstances, except when there is threat to your like life and so on, you should remain undercover. So if you see anybody giving orders, first of all, if you are in uniform, you're not in uniform and you are giving orders, maybe if you are Minister Tumkunde, who is known, you are necessarily breaking rules.
Haven't you seen that?
Well, I have. We get these reports, but I can tell you it's a gazetted mistake. Let me tell you, if you are trained and circumstances are such that, and let's threat of life is coming in, that's when you should, and you should respond with your weapon, not with orders. If it happens that you can come out, then there is one obvious thing. You are not trained, you are not adequate, you are not even fit to own what they say you are supposed to be.
Mr. Gessa, what do you make of all of this? Because the bigger question you're trying to answer is, Ona said we can guarantee that on a fair average that you can get out of here and go home and reach. But you countered that and said people have been, including people walking to the market, people walking to... The spate of criminality is fairly high.
Yes, sir. I would dare my friend Ekomoloid just to leave his car here. He walks up to the park and back. If he does that, I'll give him 1 million shillings. Because I know that I was... it is not like... I wouldn't even look at it as terrorism. But there is a situation whereby we are allowing thuggery to come up because of the way maybe we have handled information, and how, if you know, information is like a garden. You have your food there. The way you gather it is the way you use it. If you don't gather your maize, it will rot in the garden. So what I'm saying is this time it is very, very important that we bother to create a situation of like ujama intelligence, civilian intelligence. In fact, we should now request the government to allow us civilians possibly create our own bureau of investigation where we gather our own information.
The president has said we should spend $400 billion to purchase CCTV cameras.
Yes, but my comment is one. Cameras are additions, and that is more than now. But besides, I wouldn't say that if I'm in Busia and I'm followed to my garden and maybe someone kills me from there, there will be a camera. Yes, cameras are good, but the eye information, I've talked about ujama intelligence, where I use my eyes, I use everybody to comfortably bring in information, and that person is respected and that information is worked on. Now, meaning that, of course, a camera uses, you cannot take a photograph without an eye. Now, if I'm to make everybody an intelligence officer in Uganda, don't talk about you call it crime what? Crime preventers. That's a mess. Let's just accept crime prevention is a mess, because first and foremost, when you look at crime preventers, they are the poor of the poorest.
They
are not paid. Yes. You look at them. I'm telling you, you find them gathered at a police station brokering information. They can give information to anybody depending. In fact, they are almost a security threat. So what we are looking at, let's try to implement research systems. Which country has ever had 1 million crime preventers?
11 million in this country.
I mean 11 million, meaning that about a third of the country are crime preventers. But what we are seeing is...
And that's about 75% of the adult population.
You find them lined up around police, you find them chasing this and the other. Now, if they're crime preventers, they should be able to have capacity to do something and earn a living on their own. You know, intelligence is not about carrying a pistol and doing this and the other. Intelligence is about having capacity to understand the means of knowing that this may be a threat and taking it to whoever.
I'm going to ask production to put the phone number on so that a few people can call. But a quick question to you. What, as a private investigator, what would it take to track down the killers, like, for example, of Kaweesi and his colleagues and these others who have been killed?
Of course, in the private investigation almost works like any other intelligence organ. First and foremost, you should have a deployment. You should have capacity. You should definitely... There are many, many things you'd look at. you'd look at the scene and try to understand it, because the scene should drive you to where you are going. You don't speculate about politics and this and this. All these things may be there. But to me, or we private investigators, whilst it is a death is death. I mean, murder is murder, and we look at it in that way. And it's the scene, most, like in this case, when you look at the scene, I'll first of all say the scene will tell you the maybe the level of training this person had, the confidence, like General Sage. There are many, many things you look at, and then you build your story around that.
Okay.
And then you pick information as it comes. And information is with people. Information is not with the, from the air. We may bring all the gadgets we need, but information is with the people, provided we give the people confidence that their information will be portable, will be handled well, and maybe worked upon without endangering them. I'm sure that is the way to go.
That's okay. An important point.
Can we pick some callers? Hello? We have a call online. Hello? I think we lost that one. Can we pick another? Hello? Okay. As people try to get through, do we have a call? Hello? Hello?
Hello, good evening.
Good evening, sir. Your name and where are you calling from?
My name is Joseph Burite. I'm calling from around Wakiso.
Yes, Joseph. Go right ahead with your question or comment.
This phenomena of border men striking prominent people was first seen in Mombasa, in the coastal region of Kenya, around 2014. Then it went out to Tanzania. The whole of 2015, there were targets, policemen being killed, even until the end of last year. And then it also started mid-last year here in Kampala. Is there a regional element to this matter?
Okay.
Is Al-Shabaab linked to this? To this matter, you can't be saying you are going to assess now, because you must be keeping an eye on all matters that have been happening in the region. So I would like to know, is there a regional angle to this?
Thank you. Do we have another caller? Hello? Hello? Hello?
Yes, good evening.
Good evening, sir. Your name and where you're calling from?
I'm called Remo Chance, calling from Namwongo.
Yeah, please, go ahead.
I just want to pose this question. I had the general talk, and the general said that he mentioned a point saying that now that it has hit their own, that is when they are going to look into the matter so seriously. We as the community, like I guess I was telling you, when it clocks 9 or 10, you can hardly walk to the taxi park, get a taxi, get home. There are crimes that there are criminals within there that even the police themselves know. In the community around there, people know that so-and-so is a thief, so-and-so robs people. You report to the police, nothing takes place. The police even know these people. So now at this point, we've been complaining about crime, nobody listens. So it's the general trying to tell us that not until much of that happens to proficient people that we know about, that's when these things will be taken seriously.
Okay.
There are groups, people know, like for example, you cannot walk from Namwongo, monitor to the roundabout at such a time. It's known, but there's a police post around there. Then you ask yourself, what is the use of having a police post there?
Thank
in
you.
In this area where I stay, Namwongo, people are robbed at night, but we have a police station just 100 meters away from there. Then you ask yourself, okay, so not until it happens to an important person, so the rest of us are not important. So I want the general to look at such issues, like the way I'm telling you, within downtown,
okay,
we are not safe. We complain, and nobody takes it up. Some taxis that move and have these criminals inside. You board one, they rob about you. But these taxis, where do they all dock? At the old park. There's a management that is responsible about them. The police do know about them, but they do totally and absolutely nothing.
Thank
so should we keep praising our country for saying we are very...
Thank you very much, Charles. Do you have another caller? Hello? Okay. Jenna, if you could respond to these two callers, Joseph and Charles.
Yeah. Joseph, we've been monitoring this case of Mombasa, Dar es Salaam, there were a number of incidents in Kenya, and now we have what is happening here. I don't know if border is a characteristic on its own. We may have to look into it and get to understand. But you see, in Uganda, maybe I could mention a few things. That road where Kaweesi was murdered is a thin road.
Mm-hmm.
And it's very crowded. As we all went there, you could see that it is hustling to get through. There are so many people. So there is also the growing of the population. This city is very big. It's a question of, therefore, do we have enough police to command this whole growing population?
But General, you know, there is a police post, the one that provides the night guards to Kaweesi, which were providing night guards to Kaweesi at Tuba.
By the
way, just a few hundred meters behind.
You are bringing in another issue which I had forgotten. We need to change our rules. Our operational rules need to change. If you are an officer at a certain level, certain volumes of security must be applied to you, and you must live with that security, not by your choice. I don't know if you understand. So, and then there is also, I'm trying to narrow this, then I come back to this question. There is also that suburb. I started that Kulambiro suburb. I am not too sure if it is safe for an officer for the level that Kaweesi was. When you talk about these police posts...
But just a moment. Should it be about the safety of a certain level of officer? I lived in that suburb for a long time.
Yes.
Shouldn't I, am I not entitled to feel as secure as General Tumukunde or as Ona Pito? What makes the difference?
I really don't want to be misunderstood as if really we provide security for ourselves. First of all, that's unfair because for so many years I've been providing security for them. And Kampala was fairly secure. We've done quite a bit of work. And I felt sorry, or rather unsure, when somebody said, we are only coming up to solve this problem because of Kampala.
That was Charles.
No, I don't think that's what I meant to say. Maybe that's what I was under, so I'm very sorry. However, what I'm now for me studying the technicals of the case. An officer of that level should not be by one escort, as you may know. Because he's at that level, he's got quite a lot he go through on a day-to-day basis. He antagonizes very many people. He's a threat to people who want, because he should be guarded in a certain way.
Mm-hmm.
And that certain way should be enough for him to counter fire. For example, if you... I have been arguing with my people about, you know, this the minister and then the escort in one car facing one direction. You know what that could mean? Even you can see, I think Kaweesi's escort tried to react, isn't it? But you see, the circumstances are that he could not react. You understand? That's why there are many things you have to look at. If you want to solve problems, you must critically examine them. That suburb is congested. There are very many borders. When Napito was talking about why this border, you know, this border could be visiting from Entebbe, or it could be a border which they have excluded and put special numbers for the sake of, and this man may not be a border writer. He may only be knowing how to ride a border for purposes of committing crime.
But
I want to answer that question of Mombasa.
Yes.
We are looking at those patterns. By the way, I want to give assurances to Ugandans. We are going to get to the heart of this matter.
Yeah, let me request my production, my producer, to give us at least another 3 minutes so that we can...
We are going to hit the center of this problem. I can give you my assurances.
People fire for 20 minutes. That's what we're hearing. 20 minutes, rounds of bullets going off. We've been told that up to 25 bullets pumped into the car. The whole car is sprayed with bullets for years.
That doesn't take 25 minutes. Yeah. That may take 3 minutes.
No, I mean
shooting that runs for that long, and without adequate response immediately, and people are able to disappear into thin air.
You see, disappearing in thin air is because of that means of transport, isn't it? And that's why I'm you see, our minds are set in completely different ways. Me, I'm a security, because you use a border for maneuverability to be able to actually withdraw, isn't it, after crime. But what also is important is the crowd. And this police force you are talking about are manned by three or four people. They are not necessarily very many. And they've got quite a lot to attend to. And on hearing fire, he knows. You don't just follow fire. You understand the pattern of the fire. You understand the source of the fire. There are many things you have to evaluate before you storm in. You see, I think this Kaweesi's escort was trying to hear. I'm also talking about how you provide for your own people in terms of security. Mm-hmm. You know, although we are always saying inefficient, there's also the kind of, you know, for example, in other countries, as Mr. Gessa knows, people are not covered. You see a British minister traveling in a train. You think he's not covered? They are covered. But the kind of expense that is required to take care of those kind of is quite heavy, as you may know. So that's why we use the fairly cruder means. But we are learning. I can tell you, and we shall provide security for Ugandans. These criminals who've been here, I'm told, collaborating with police as the people are raising here, we shall take it on. I give you my assurance, we shall take it on. We shall sort out this part very soon. Yes,
but I think
fortunately, it has now come to everybody's mind that this is a matter we need to give maximum attention. Usually, police is dividing its own attention. You know very well. We have issues like you're talking about crime and Bukede. In test, by the way, we've talking on those. I myself have sent investigators to Kenya. We've done. It's not that when a matter has not been solved, it's not because it's not being attended to. It is being attended to, but the whole issue is we have to refine how we tackle it by creating sufficient evidence on the matter and then collaborating between ourselves and security agencies.
Just one more thing, and then I guess and Honor will come in as we close the show. Tackling politicians, for example. Basically, is moving from Kasangati and we'll see all squads of policemen, vehicles and everybody. And you can afford to have so many policemen camp at his house for so long when crime is growing elsewhere. You can afford to have policemen watching over Semu Junganda in Chira, watching over Ingrid Turinawe, watching over Elias Lukwago, watching over Kiza Besigye, watching over Mbaraka Munyagwa, all over the place. And they will be all over. But when it comes to security of ordinary people, now even important people, absent.
Mr. Mwamsha, every part of what you are talking about is a security component. It depends what at this particular time is graded as being important in terms of disrupting the public or causing threat to the public. It doesn't mean that other matters are not being attended.
Can grading go wrong? Can there be wrong grading?
Sometimes it can be. It can be. But you know, what you must always do is self-renewal. You know, examining a situation, evaluating performance. We do it regularly to make sure that you keep. Now, the biggest question is, are we on top of the situation? Now I can tell you, it is everybody's answer. From me to the layman, to my grandmother in the village.
What is the answer?
The answer is that we are not on top of the situation. Now we'll go back as security agencies. In fact, we are having consultations. I remember even on the scene, we did a lot of consultations. We met there and agreed that some of the things need to be taken on. But you know, you see, the biggest asset this country has is security. Invest in security. Yes.
Will the cameras work? The president has.
The cameras will help. Yes, they will help. I hope you accompany them with writing. You know, these things duplicity of them. I hope you accompany them with writing. Because without writing, the cameras will not be effective.
And the personnel to watch.
There are personnel to correct this data. There are personnel to monitor hotspots. There's quite a bit of things to do.
Okay.
But why sometimes we improvise is because the demands of security sometimes are too expensive for our budget, regardless of whether this threat is big enough or not. That's why we are always improvising sometimes. You hear these crime preventers. You may say, yes, but in the absence of nothing, you have to be seen to be doing something. So I think even crime preventers, you can put them on because they help to, although, as I said before, they must receive some minimum training in order for them to own the name of a security agent.
Oh, you wanted to come in now.
Mine is just, I think the general and all his counterparts, a president was talking about civil servants demanding a lot of money and then disrupting the investment in security. I hope part of the investment in security is actually paying the security authorities, including police, more. And by so doing, you then reduce what I'm seeing as a very dangerous element of police being used for private gain by a lot of people who think they have money. You see things like around evictions, people are saying, why is police being used? They should just be auctioneers, they should be court bailiffs, somehow. And when you have this kind of police involvement or security involvement, it interacts with the money. Because if you are going to use, if some rich person influences police to go and help them execute an activity, another rich person is aggrieved. And that kind of interaction can lead to security operatives being seen as an enemy of somebody. And then criminals are hired maybe to take on the security operatives. So please pay your operatives more money and then reduce their usage for private gain.
Yes, if you could respond to that and also conclude the answer to...
You remember there was a question raised by Roman Charles, and I'll come back to him. You see, gentlemen, Uganda can only be Uganda. Yes, we have certain means. We have to live in those kind of means. Do you know how much you need to do this city cameras you are talking about?
The president has missed 400 million. 400 billion.
400 billion.
Yes.
Put it against your budget. You can tell us. And you know what goes with it? You have to have data collecting personnel. You've got to have
computer systems.
Yes, you have got to have full-fledged lighting. So the main question is, you live in Fort Potro, Mr. Mouse.
Yes.
Have you met a DISO?
I think we have a DISO, yes.
Is he the most facilitated?
I'm not sure. I don't know.
No, you must be having the capacity to judge things. Mm-hmm. So the whole issue is the threat could be bigger than our budget. But we are trying to work within our means. It doesn't mean that if Uganda's budget is less. And we've done very well. Because
but
I don't want anybody to give an impression here.
Let me talk about that. The president said
mm-hmm.
police has been infiltrated by criminals. Kale, you must clean the police, especially the CID group. This is the president speaking himself. And he said, police, clean your house. You are also contributing to the death of our people. The president, more than anyone else, is aware that we have budgetary constraints. But he locates the problem within the functionality of the institution.
What did the honorable Napito raise just that I didn't want to push it further? How much do you pay this policeman? It's not necessary. You see, first of all, we need to go to ideology. I've been in Chuba. They pay a Chuban doctor $200. He's satisfied because he's come to understand that's what Chuba can afford in this particular time. When you come to Ugandans, people tell you there is a lot out there. We simply don't get to reach it. The truth is that look at your budget. What can it provide? So we have to go to ideological. You know very well we're in the bush. Whenever we talk about bush, people say, bush, what? Let me tell you, we lived in the bush without shoes, without anything, because we were properly ideologically oriented.
So what has happened to you when I try to
create a technical person to help us in the Ministry of Security in this kind of areas? When you talk to a cyber expert, he says, yes sir, I'll be helping, but I want $40,000 because that's what the, an American agency is paying somewhere. Now, if it goes like that, do you think we need to reorient ourselves? Actually, this is from civil servants, anybody who is serving public good, including yourself being part of the information network. Have you seen what happens with the British? You go and be a neighbor of UNAPTO, and whenever you come in, you fight at the gate. You quietly call the police. Go and deposit $50,000 in a British bank. You say, thank you very much, sign you in. He'll call the police immediately and say, you know one thing? Some peculiar black came here and he deposited unusual money here. This is our job. For me, I want to, I don't want to philosophize. But we need, first of all, to accept that these are our means. And it must be the duty of every Ugandan to make sure that we judge, I mean, we secure our country. Let me tell you that from before, at one point when I was going to, we were tracking some rebels who were entering Uganda in northeastern, in eastern Uganda. This man stopped us. We were in uniform. The man said, no, I am the security officer of this area. I said, but sir, you can see we are on duty. He said, no, I want to know where you are going. And people were getting to be rough. I said, leave him. And you know what he said? He told us finally. He said, 1 kilometer away, that's where the enemy is. You don't want to be helped. What if I released you and you went and they killed you? What would be my job here? I wish we could have thousands of those.
How did you lose those thousands of people who existed without you paying them? They did exist?
It is because the ideological orientation has been changing corners.
We keep hearing vigilance, we keep hearing neighborhood watch, we keep hearing those words. They are slogans.
Yeah,
I mean, everybody is...
Slogans going in which direction?
I don't know. You should tell.
Are you trying to tell me that it's something you don't understand?
No,
you don't know what purpose it is for.
We hear it.
Until you label it, until you label it a slogan.
Why it's not functioning is what I'm asking.
But you see, I can also tell you, Mr. Mwangusia, it's all our business. You can't leave a child to your wife, and you always say the child is going wrong. We all have an important role. I am here. I have apologized to Ugandans. We are going to take it on, I can tell you.
Okay.
But again, Ugandans must take particular interest in their security.
Mr. Gessa, the minister is talking about Ugandans taking interest in their security. I think Ugandans have an interest in their security. The difference is people have been trying to invest in private security because public security either has been compromised or is inadequate. And I'll give you an example. In traffic, I've been unfortunate to have my phone snatched. The other day I was moving and I saw a thief try to snatch a phone from a lady who was in front of me in traffic. And no one was bothered. I tried to get out and chase after the thief, but he ran away. Unfortunately, he didn't take the phone. The thing is, people will tell you, ah, you mean you're driving without your windows up? You mean you don't have a dog at home? You mean you don't have Sekanyolia? You mean you don't have this? If the public is spending so much, and the higher profile someone is, the higher the wall is, the more the security guards they have, the more the security cameras they have, privatized security for individuals feeds corruption, influence peddling, that one I was talking about, and stuff like that, but compromises the general security of everyone else. That's why you have a border stage, about 100 meters. I think you saw the signpost going to 50 meters, Columbia Gardens. And no one there is communicating and saying, there seems to be a problem here when people have these mobile phones.
Yeah, my answer is, I know people have information and people would love to tell the public, to tell security, or they can stand or they get suspicious of. But the problem has been, whom do you tell? I think possibly a general baby designer. Who do we tell? So we possibly the public should now come up and we start our own civilian intelligence bureau, which whereby we get our own information, then we know who to give the information to. Because even giving information sometimes it can be double-edged. Because you may give information to someone thinking he's a police officer, thinking he's someone who is going to be of use, and then tomorrow you have issues. So what I'm saying in this regard, like even you talked about cameras, if we don't fight corruption like we're fighting a lion, it's still someone will switch off the cameras. You know, what we have to look at seriously is we have to utilize civilian intelligence, how to suck it down, we have to design guidances, because information, all the information you need to know is on the ground. It's only the way we should harvest it. Lastly, possibly, why I always talk about our civilian bureau, let the public know that we are losing a lot of interest in the police. People are looking at police as if they are their enemies because of one reason. If you you may be locked up. Recently, I had a case whereby someone who repaired a vehicle in November, and I think it was stolen in January, was arrested and kept in cells for another 5 days. So you look at a situation whereby that is antagonism. So the public relations, the relationship between police and the public has collapsed to the extent that people look at police as another item and another entity.
Okay.
Yeah. So I think we have to straighten a few things here and there.
Honorable Minister, you have the last word.
Give me a minute.
Sure.
First of all, thank you for calling us here, and we want to use this opportunity to communicate to the public. Number one, we shall take it on this matter. Number two, we are going to make sure that we work jointly, as we did before when we had this kind of problem. We're going to work jointly to make sure that on a day-to-day basis, we are exchanging information, acting together, and we shall certainly bring this back.
I'm told that's the biggest problem within the agencies.
Well, let your view remain yours. The other point I want to make, from tomorrow we shall put together these obstacles. Which system obstacles the other? Which system does not flow quickly? Is it the judiciary? Is it? You remember, Mr. Mong said you were already quite in circulation. We had an operational team which had police, prison, prosecution, you know, like a one-stop center. That's how we brought terrorism to an end here and really curtailed its performance for now quite a long time. Although you are saying terrorists, you should go where terrorists have really taken over countries. Here we are still doing very well. But we still must apologize for the bits we are not doing very well. The fourth point I want to make, Mr. Mwangusha, is that security needs to be supported. If from you, the person, and I agree with Mr. Gessa, we shall clean the beat where people fear to report to us. Even me, I'm now like breaking into some IO of sorts, Minister Tumukundi. People tell me, I can only give you this information, only you. You know what that means? He's not too sure how it will be used by another party. Now I'm an IO of sorts.
So information is for sale?
No, it's not actually, no, it's not about sale. It's about confidence. If I give it to you, I know it won't be used against me. But these are simple crimes of corruption. I can tell you, we'll bring them to an end. But support us in terms of giving us information. Support us in terms of facilitating us when we come to you. When we go to Parliament, everyone should understand that we need support. Support us when we need to train, even when it is expensive. Support us when we want to buy equipment, even when it is expensive. Because the cost of having more security, no security, is a lot more expensive. Once this machine falls, like you've had, tourism collapsing in some of our neighboring countries, you know what happened. Have you been to Mombasa recently? Do you know why? Do you know how much money they are losing? Insecurity. So please put security in front of your spending chain. Help security, provide for them. We understand the difficulties of our country. We know the levels of economy, but give us support. Finally, the last point I want to make. Ugandans should report any incident. Even when according to you it's not suspicious enough, find a way of reporting it. And from tomorrow, we are going to provide, ways of having you report matters. Now you can do it even electronic. Like they're always on social media, exchanging so many small things. Maybe the social media should be used to alert security about certain things.
Okay.
Even small as you may look at it, you just pass on the information.
Let me just risk this, because it's been making rounds on social media, especially since the president talked about the 400 billion for cameras. The thing people say, maybe this incident, unfortunate as it is, provides an opportunity for people in security to make some money. They're asking, who is going to procure these? Now everybody, every big person will need an armored vehicle, because armored vehicles have only been restricted to, I saw three people, the president, I think vice president, and somebody posted on social media and said, Mama Mbabazi, the others don't have armored vehicles. Now, people, big people are going to have that. The question, you emphasize support, the need for support to, on budget, for example, when you need money. And people are going to say, no, providing just an opportunity for people to make money privately. How do you respond to that?
You know, the evils of corruption should not overwhelm our important target of providing security for the country. Corruption will be isolated and it will be extinguished. But where there is a need to promote security, promote it willingly. About who purchases, you know, these budgets for in different sectors of government. So I don't know how they purchase, but for me, as far as I'm concerned, where we are in control, we have used this money before correctly, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
We have used it before correctly, as you may know. So the whole issue is not necessary. Corruption will be isolated. It should not become the full excuse of not giving enough to security as they require.
Our time is out. We need to get out of here. I keep complaining when the news overruns, and the production people have been complaining that we have overrun the show. But thank you very much. Lieutenant General.
Thank you very much, and we want to really reiterate our condolences to these people. We want to apologize to Ugandans that there were these incidents, but we also want to tell Ugandans that we have done so well in terms of providing security. We are better than most countries here. I don't think you want to compare us to Somalia. I don't want to compare us to Central Africa. I don't want you to compare us to Congo. I don't want you to compare us. We have done very well.
You're raising examples of failed states.
No, I'm talking about insecurity. Well, I can raise other examples. I'm being diplomatic.
Mm-hmm.
They are not far from you. But Uganda is certainly doing very well.
Okay, thank you very much.
We shall use these incidents to make sure that we work with Ugandans to sort out this problem. And I give you my assurances that with support, for us, we are going to sort out ourselves.
Okay.
Then with support, we should bring this matter.
Thank you very much. We've got to close it there. Of course, as the Fourth Estate, extend our condolences to the family of Andrew Felix Kaweesi. He was a guest, he used to be a guest on this show. To the family of Kenneth Erau, and to the family of Godfrey Nambeo. Kenneth Erau will be buried tomorrow in Namuria. I'm not sure about the burial of Godfrey. Unfortunately, it hasn't been talked about that much. I think the burial will also be taking place either tomorrow or the other day.
Yeah.
And the burial of Andrew Felix Kaweesi will be on Tuesday. There will be a funeral service. The official funeral service will be tomorrow at Rubaga Cathedral. And of course, NTV will continue to bring you live updates and on whatever will be going on in that direction, towards his send-off. From me, have a good night.